Today is the first of a series of lectures on trade and economies of scale. In this one, we're going to look at trade and external economies of scale. We've already looked at a number of theories which implicitly make predictions about which countries should trade the most. So comparative advantage says the trade ought to occur most between countries which have different levels of productivity. The Heckscher-Ohlin theory says that trade ought to occur the most between countries with different factor shares. So both of these theories imply that countries should trade the most with countries from which they are the most different. However, a large fraction of trade actually occurs between countries which are quite similar in productivity and in factor shares. For example, there's a huge amount of trade between US and Canada. And more generally, there's a lot of trade between the United States, Canada, Western Europe, and Japan, the developed economies. Now, this doesn't mean that comparative advantage and Heckscher-Ohlin theory are wrong, but it does certainly mean that they're incomplete. And we want to look at some other theories which may help us to explain some of the facts about trade. In particular, we're going to be focusing on economies of scale, which come in two types. First, external economies of scale. These are at the industry level, and I'll explain this more as I go along. And then second, internal economies of scale at the firm level. It turns out that the second is more difficult to analyze analytically because it requires us to understand monopolistic competition. We can't have straightforward competition with internal economies of scale at the firm level. So we'll talk more about that in a future lecture. Today we're going to focus on external economies of scale. Let's take a look. An important fact about many industries is they're not spread randomly around a country or around the world. Take carpet, for example. For over 100 years, the city of Dalton has been known as the carpet capital of the world. Over 100 firms produce carpet in Dalton, Georgia, and they combined produce over 70% of the world's entire production of tufted carpet. Now, not all industries cluster. So which ones cluster and why did they cluster? Why did Dalton, Georgia become the carpet capital of the world? Industrial clusters are very common. There's a small town in China with a population of just 36,000 that makes over 3 billion toothbrushes a year. Hongji, China produces 80% of China's toothbrush production. There are over 990 manufacturers in the Hongji cluster. And toothbrushes have been made there since 1827. That's another interesting fact about these clusters. Once they start, they tend to remain in place for a long time. They're very stable. Here's another cluster with which you're very familiar, Hollywood. Why is it that so many movies, not just in the United States, but for the world, are made in Hollywood? And if they're not made in Hollywood, they're probably made in another industrial cluster, Bollywood, in India. In order to understand why some industries cluster, it's useful to think about how a cluster evolves. And these principles have repeated themselves over and over again in many different types of industries. So typically, first one firm enters, and it might enter at a particular location due, let's say, to some geographic factors which lower its costs modestly in that location. So for example, California is good for filming all year round, so it made some sense for an early movie studio to begin in California. The first entrant doesn't have to have cost advantages, however. Dalton, Georgia got its start when a young girl handcrafted a bedspread, which proved particularly popular. She got her friends making similar bedspreads, and this gave rise to an entire industry. Now think about a second firm. It looks around and asks where should it locate. And it notices that by locating near the first firm, it can take advantage of some specialized labor, of suppliers, of shippers, of some ready-made infrastructure. So the second firm enters at the same location. The third firm finds cost advantages of locating near the first two even greater. And so a cluster begins to develop until pretty soon this one spot happens to be the lowest cost place to producing that particular type of good. Let's think about Hollywood, for example. In order to make a movie, you need very quickly to assemble a large team of specialized, talented labor. if you're making a movie in Dubuque, Iowa, and your cameraman gets sick and heaven forbids dies, it's going to be really hard to find another cameraman. If you're making the same movie in the LA area, you can have another cameraman there in hours. And suppliers, if you need in your movie, suddenly you need a rewrite and you need to have an alien costume and a Roman temple, you can have all of those goods delivered to you. There are prop shops built, large prop shops, which service the entire industry. So at low cost, you can find things that you want very quickly. The same thing is true for carpets, which are created through specialized machinery, which requires informed, educated labor. So it's no surprise that the community colleges in Dalton, Georgia, also specialize in teaching people the skills used to make carpets. Even producing toothbrushes can require a lot of specialized machinery, and it helps for a firm to be located in the Hangzhou area because it can easily find the labor and the expertise that it needs in order to build toothbrushes. So this is how an industry evolves to become a cluster, and when it is clustered, it becomes the lowest cost place to produce these particular types of goods. Clusters can also help to create new innovations and inventions and improvements, which lower the cost curve even further at any different quantity. So the great economist Alfred Marshall said, "Great are the advantages which people following the same skilled trade get from near neighborhood. The mysteries of the trade become no mysteries, but are, as it were, in the air, and children learn many of them unconsciously. This is definitely the case in Dalton, Georgia, and in Hangzhou, China. Good work is rightly appreciated. Inventions and improvements in machinery, in processes, and the general organization of the business have their merits promptly discussed. If one man starts a new idea, it is taken up by others and combined with suggestions of their own, and thus it becomes the source of further new ideas." So again, once a cluster becomes established, the costs fall quickly in that cluster, first in that cluster. They fall there before they fall anywhere else. And again, this is the reason why a firm wants to be located in a cluster with other similar firms. External economies of scale imply that as the industry gets larger, the costs of each firm in that industry begin to fall. And this means that the supply curve for the industry can actually be downward sloping, at least over a part of its range. So the supply or industry average cost curve, in contrast to the usual supply curve, which is upward sloping, can actually slope downwards, particularly as the cluster is being established. So when Dalton, Georgia is small, the carpet industry has high costs. But as the industry in Dalton grows larger, the costs to each firm in that industry begin to fall. Notice that what this means is that when an industry is large, it's going to be very difficult to start an industry anywhere else because the costs to production are lowest in Dalton, Georgia, where it already has economies of scale, where the economies of scale have already been built up. Let's now see what implications there are for trade when we have external economies of scale. So let's suppose that there are two industries, toothbrushes and carpets, two countries, the United States and China, or Canada, if you like, it doesn't matter which. And let's suppose that we have no trade. So in the initial equilibrium, let's suppose that the US demand is in blue and the Chinese demand, we'll say, is in green. Same thing over here, US demand for carpets is in blue, Chinese demand for carpets is in green. So the demand is the size of the market in these two countries. Given the size of the market, given the demand in the United States, the price of toothbrushes in the United States will be here, and the quantity of toothbrushes sold will be here. Same thing for carpets, the price of US carpets is given here and the quantity here. China has got a, let's say, slightly bigger market than the U.S. market. So because of economies of scale, it has a lower price of toothbrushes and a bigger quantity. And same here, a lower price of carpets and a bigger quantity. We could mix and match these however we want. It doesn't really matter. Now, here's the point. Suppose that we now introduce trade. Well, what will happen? Well, one thing which could happen is that these industries cluster in just such a way that we get more of both goods. So for example, let's look at the total world demand for toothbrushes, which is simply just the US demand plus the Chinese demand. So this is the total world demand for toothbrushes. This is the total world demand for carpet. Again, just the US demand plus the Chinese demand. Now, if now we have a cluster such that all the toothbrushes are made in China and all the carpets are made in the United States, then the cost of producing toothbrushes falls, the cost of producing carpets falls, so now China produces a lot more toothbrushes, their quantity of production increases, the United States produces a lot more carpet, but because the cost of both of these goods has fallen due to taking advantage of these external economies of scale, China and the United States can trade carpet for toothbrushes, and both countries can be better off. So by taking advantage of larger markets allow you to extract everything possible from these external economies of scale. By building the toothbrush industry bigger in one location and building the carpet industry in Dalton, Georgia, by making that larger, we can take advantage of all the possible external economies of scale, push our costs down to the minimum level, and then trade. And since costs for both products have gone down, both countries will be better off. Let's look at two interesting effects in the presence of external economies of scale. First, I'm going to call this the big get bigger effect. Let's take a look. Suppose there are two countries. We're going to call them big and small. The big country is not necessarily big in size, but it has a big market for this particular product. So here's the demand curve for big, here's the one for small. Also, we're going to suppose that the average cost curve or the supply curve in the big market does not fall as far as in the small market. In other words, at any particular quantity, the cost of producing that quantity of good are lower in the small market than they are in the big market. However, the big market starts off big. So the big market starts off with a cost advantage due to the fact that it can take advantage of these economies of scale. So now notice what happens if we now introduce free trade. Well, if we have free trade and here's our world demand curve, we may end up at what I call the historical equilibrium. That is, something plausible which happens is that the big market gets bigger. Because it begins with the cost advantage, it's able to outcompete the suppliers in the small market so that we end up with the big market taking the dominant share, taking the world market. That historical equilibrium is opposed to the ideal equilibrium. If everything was ideal, the location of the cluster would be in the small market because that's where you reduce costs the most. But because the small market starts off small, it ends up even smaller. The big get bigger, the small get smaller. So in theory, what this means is that we don't always end up at the ideal equilibrium. This is a little bit sad, probably not too much to worry about, because what we really want to do is make sure that we take advantage of the trade to take advantage of these economies of scale. But it does mean that we don't necessarily get to the ideal equilibrium. The chains of history bind us so that we may end up at the historical equilibrium. The second effect, the there can only be one effect, is closely related. There can only be one Dalton, Georgia. There can only be one Seattle, Washington, or Silicon Valley, or Hollywood. I mean, literally, this is not true, but there certainly aren't going to be many. So some people argue that in order to be the one, we should have strategic trade policy. That is, there are some benefits to being Dalton, Georgia, or to being Seattle, Washington, or Silicon Valley. And if we could, we would like to be the ones who eat up those benefits. So what these people suggest is that we ought to, for example, protect our industries. We ought to throw up tariffs and barriers to trade so that our small industries become big. We allow them to grow until they get the cost advantages of economies of scale, and only then do we open them up to world trade. And because we only open up to world trade once our industries have got these economies of scale, we're then able to dominate the world and take over these industries. We may end up at the historical equilibrium, or if we're lucky, we may end up at the ideal equilibrium if we happen to start off small and then we grew our industry. But either way, the point of strategic trade policy is that we end up being the one. Now, again, this idea works in theory. In practice, it can be a little bit dangerous. If every country tries to be the one, then every country may end up trying to protect its industries, trying to grow its industries behind these tariff walls, and we may never get the advantages of the economies of scale which free trade can produce. So for the world as a whole, it's probably more important that industries cluster around the world, and we take advantage of clustering and then trade, than it is that we are the ones who end up with the cluster. It would be nice if we did, but we probably can't tip the balance that often. It's going to be very tricky to be able to tip the balance in our favor, and the times in which we are able to tip the balance probably do not justify the number of times where, because of the tariffs and the quotas, we don't get all of the economies of scale that we can get. Anyway, that's my opinion from evaluating this literature. Other people may differ, but strategic policy is something which can work in theory. One more point before we conclude. External economies of scale and dynamic economies of scale can also occur across industries. That is, the ideas in one industry can cross-pollinate or fertilize ideas in another industry, can lower costs in another industry. Having a lot of smart people together in an area where they can communicate with one another, you never know what idea is going to be particularly fruitful, be particularly profitable in a place where the first person might never have thought to apply that idea, but the second person can apply that idea. These are also called agglomeration economies or synergies. And this most fundamentally explains why we have cities. After all, there are a lot of disadvantages to cities. There are congestion, it's more expensive to live in a city, costs are higher in a city, and yet people are more productive in cities. It's not just that more productive people go to live in cities, although that happens too, it's that the same people are more productive in a city. They generate more ideas when they're around other people who generate ideas. So this explains why the external economies of scale in international trade also have implications for economic geography, and it's why Paul Krugman, for example, made pioneering contributions to both fields. Anyway, perhaps we'll say more about that another day, but it's a little bit far afield, so we'll turn now to further references. So Paul Krugman's 1996 paper does a good job explaining increasing returns and how they apply to trade and also to clusters. Clusters are also discussed in Michael Porter's book from a business point of view. This is a more empirical point of view, The Competitive Advantage of Nations. The World Bank, their 2009 report, has got a lot of information on clusters from all over the world. And Paul Krugman's 1991 book, Geography and Trade, explains the link in greater detail between international trade, the ideas of international trade, and the ideas of economic geography. Thanks.